All right, everyone, again, to the families that came, if you'd like to sit and watch your kids from here, feel free to come in. You can come in if you'd like. Oh, yeah. And we do record these meetings, so if you're uncomfortable being on camera, be not so close to the center table. All right, I'm going to call the meeting to order by President at 6 p.m. For those who participate, you may not rise for the Pledge of Allegiance. Amazing. Resolution number one, acceptance of agenda. Do I have a motion? I heard Hedwan. Do I have a second? Okay, order, please. Please.
Third graders. You need to chill.
Motion by Hedwan, seconded by Hall. Resolve upon the recommendation of the super, the Board of Ed accepts and approves the agenda with any additions or deletions. All in favor? Aye. Any opposed? Motion carries 5 ayes, 2 absences. We're going to switch the order up. As you can see, we have a full room of lovely third graders. So this evening, we are going to get a music performance by Mr. Spade, third grade class from Holbrook Elementary. So thank you
and
so much.
And Dickinson West.
And Dickinson West. Thank you so much.
Yes. Come on in. Okay, stand up, please.
You don't have to bear that you can.
much. Max, would you mind getting a group photo with the board and the students?
Yeah. You guys got them around here? Okay. Stay where you are for a minute. Stay where you are. Kosciuszko All-Star Coalition trip to Texas. It will be presented by Ms. Kuzner and Ms. Goodrich. Do you guys have any students with you?
We have one, yes.
Amazing. Come on up.
We also have physical copies of the presentation if you would all like some. Here we go.
Oh, I'm sorry.
We have Shannon and Lara. No, Ms. Kuzner.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So Ms. Goodridge said my name already, but my name is Shannon Schaefer, and I work with the Hamtramck Drug-Free Community Coalition, and myself as well as Laura, we went on the trip to Texas with the students. So I will actually be presenting a portion of the presentation that was meant to be presented by a student named Muhammad. Unfortunately, he's very sick, so he cannot join us today, but I will be presenting an initial portion. So this is highlights from CADCA Mid-Year 2023, and we went back in July from the 16th to the 20th, and that was at the Gaylord Texan in Grapevine, Texas. So these are pictures from day one. We checked into the conference space. They got badges with their names on them. We also got bags, and we were able to check in and see and meet a bunch of new people, and we had our own breakout session. This was called the Catalyst Crew, and this was maybe 50 to 60 other students in there, as well as chaperones. So at that time, we were able to play a bunch of different games, get to meet new people. There was actually another group there from Detroit as well, so it was kind of fun to see relatively familiar faces. And we also participated in a game called the True Colors Word Sort. So I had never done this before, but it was a great way to get to know your strengths and weaknesses, and a great way for them to kind of break the ice among the people that they were getting to know. And then they started to talk about leadership. So these are the 7 C's of leadership that they covered at the conference. So this is, again, another way to tie in their strengths and weaknesses and maybe think about how that ties into leadership. They also learned about the 12 sectors of community, which is important because later they'd be talking about community change. So this gave them a better idea about a different way to think about Hamtramck as a community and how to create change within that community.
To wrap up that first day, we had opportunities to explore the beautiful resort that that we were in, some great new experiences for our students. There was an awesome event that evening where all the youth from around the country were able to just gather, kind of a meetup and chill, hang out with some fun activities. So good fun opportunity for these students. Day two, we did start the day just getting to know the group that we were working with throughout the week a little bit more, and additional opportunities to explore the resort, but then also, of course, learn. We kind of the big focus for that day was the what's called the Strategic Prevention Framework, and I also am a staff of Hamtramck Drug-Free Community Coalition, and this is something that we use often in anything that we want to do to promote community change. Any type of activity that we're doing, we want to follow this process. So it was a great opportunity for the students to learn this process as well. That consists of kind of assessing the needs of the community, building capacity of the community so that we can address those needs, planning whatever activity that we feel the community is in need of, implementing that activity, then evaluating how that goes. And in the course of all that, just making sure that we're remaining sustainable and culturally competent. So step one of this process, the students had an opportunity to participate in, so assessing needs of the community. So we had opportunities to really discuss our community. The students spent time making this map, kind of identifying what our community looks like, what it's made up of, where are locations that may be of concern or have more needs, or locations that you know might be a resource for the community. So once we're done doing that,
we created a problem statement. Now that we talked about the community needs and resources, and the problem statement we made is vaping in Hamtramck among school ages youth.
The problem solved.
So at the end of the day two, we have some fun. We went to the pool, and that's my first time in the pool.
Did you have fun?
Yeah.
I love that.
The third day, the last day, we explored the hotel more, and we saw some cool things. And we at the end of the day three, we went to the mall. The root causes but why social access and retail access. The root causes is the identified. Now we determine the who, what, and where.
So this is something called a logic model. So they created the problem statement. They decided what they felt are the root causes of that problem within Hamtramck. So they chose social access and retail access. And using those two root causes, they were able to create local conditions. So like Sharif said, this is the who, what, and where. So it was a statement that kind of summarized and something that you could visualize as what the problem and the local condition kind of looked like. So for social access, that first local condition is students sharing their vapes in the school gym, bathroom, and classrooms, and also students selling to each other or getting someone to buy a vape for them. So that all has to do with social access as the root cause. And then retail access as the root cause, they chose two different local conditions there as well. So they see gas stations and smoke shops are selling vapes to youth without IDs, and they also see that youth are purchasing fake IDs from local sources to also access vapes as well.
I think this is a really important part, because when you're able to identify those very specific things like this, when you're getting down to what are you seeing, what can you take a picture of, it's just that much easier to then, okay, what can we do to respond to that or prevent it? So great opportunity, again, for those students. So that kind of brings us to that next step. What is our action plan to address these very specific things that the students are seeing? So we kind of took that first local condition. The students are, you know, unfortunately seeing that vapes are being shared in school. So here's our action plan to kind of address that, very specific steps. So research vape detectors, fundraise for them, purchase vape detector, get staff on board, train them how to utilize them, install the vape detectors, and again, evaluate that important piece. And I will say this is something actually that would normally be on this action plan, would be, of course, to get approval and things like that. But we do have on board already administration and things like that. So we've had that seal of approval already, so we're kind of moving forward from there. Oh, and so this is just a kind of end of the week, I guess, a visual of our whole group. Again, we had the opportunity to meet with other groups throughout Michigan, but throughout the country as well. So full group that we spent the week with, and our students, Tashia, Sharif, and Muhammad, who had the opportunity to kind of share out what they were doing that whole week. All those things that you saw, the logic model, the maps, and everything, all the things that you heard about are things that came from directly from our students. So they got that opportunity to share out after and now for you. So we just want to say, on behalf of HDFCC, and then also, of course, the Kosciuszko All-Star Coalition, thank you for allowing us to attend. We just had an awesome time, great experience.
How hot was it in Texas in August?
What, 107, 108 every day? It was hot.
You guys made it back. Thank you so much.
Yes, of course. I do also have extras if you want any, but I can also take them with me. If you're fine with just a copy that you have.
No, we're good. Okay. Thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you.
Amazing. Next up, we have Jessica Madden for the Outdoor Adventure Field Trip. Jessica, are you in the audience?
I think there was a little miscommunication that we were supposed to have a student presentation. And our Outdoor Adventure Club is currently A lot of them are part of dual enrollment, so they are very busy, and we have an event coming up this weekend, so they're home doing that, but they will be happy to come and present next month or whenever. I made a slide for you, which I didn't share, so it was like in my last 5 minutes of my prep period, so I apologize, I'll just talk. So I think we're going to use this time just to maybe tell you about the experience that we're going to hopefully do this weekend, and then I see it's down on the agenda for the approval. So
yeah.
I made a slide, it was like the who, what, when, where, why. So this is Ms. Harkleroad. She is social worker in Hamtramck High. So we have a fall outdoor adventure team at Hamtramck High. There are 20 students. And this is our week 3 of our club. So every Thursday, we've gone and done some sort of local activity. So we did putt-putt at Lasky Park, and we went and hiked at Bald Mountain in Lake Orion. And then last week, we rode bikes in the rain with Wheelhouse Detroit. And all the activities that we're doing are actually couched in a unit that that five of our students designed with me and with Wayne County RESA this summer. And the unit is kind of an environmental literacy unit that is attached to outdoor adventure. So before each activity, the students or myself, we lead a lesson. So last week, before we rode on the riverfront, it was all about watersheds and where does our water go. And it was perfect because it was raining and the water's going to drain. And so we got to see the water, you know, going into the Detroit River and talk about what to do to help protect our watersheds. So this week, to end our fall adventure, we've been invited by the National Oceanic Atmospheric Administration, who are stationed at the Maritime Heritage, Great Lakes Maritime Heritage Museum in Alpena. And they want to host us for the weekend to camp at Ossineke State Campground. And then, so they are going to have us spend the day at the museum, and then afterwards head out on kayaks on the lake. There's a whole, it's an underwater nature preserve. It's called, it's like part of, I don't know, it's like 1,000 miles. It's like a national park underwater because of the shipwrecks. Mm-hmm. So we're going to kayak over some shipwrecks, hopefully, as long as the weather's fine. And then we'll be doing a hike at Rockport State Park, where there's like a fossil dig, and another hike at possibly Negwagon State Park, if we can fit it all in. And then we'll camp overnight Friday night. All those activities will happen Saturday. Camp overnight Saturday night, and then do a little campground cleanup Sunday morning and come home. It's about 4 hours away. There are four of us chaperones. So there's myself, Miss Wilson, Miss Harkleroad. Miss Wilson and I have wilderness first aid training, wilderness first aid certification. Also going with us is Uriel Vargas from Detroit Outdoors, and he's approved through the volunteer through Hamtramck already, and he is a wilderness first responder. And we're borrowing gear from Detroit Outdoors. We're taking a school bus up, they'll be dropping us off, and then the Maritime Heritage Museum is paying for shuttle buses to kind of take us from event to event. The other funding that is paying for it is we received a grant last spring through the Ralph C. Wilson Foundation. So this field trip fulfills the grant. So the idea of the grant's called Project Play, is that we're introducing young people to many different kinds of outdoor activities. So that's why we've done kayak, well, we haven't done kayaking yet. We've done biking, hiking, the putt-putt, and then we'll end with the camping, kayaking, hiking again. So I think, was there anything else? Who, what, when, where, why? Oh, why? Besides fulfilling our grant, it's also part of, you know, just learning about the cultural and historical legacy of Michigan and the Great Lakes and the shipping industry. So it kind of ties everything together. And then that will end our fall outdoor adventure season. Mm-hmm. And then just looking forward, so you know what's coming up. in October, we have signups for ski snowboard. They have SOS Detroit, which helps us, really they run most of it. They are opening it up to allow Hamtramck High to have 50 students this year. We have 25 returning who will become mentors in the program, and then we have 25 new students who can ski snowboard. So that will happen starting from January through March, and then we have this relationship with Crystal Mountain up in near Traverse, so they'll probably invite us up again. And then we'll have a spring outdoor adventure team where we'll have be able to have 20 students again, and we'll kind of repeat what we've done with the fall, but hopefully have a kind of some leaders will stay, but a kind of fresh group of students to run through. Should add, Miss Kumar here.
Hi.
Is now connected to SOS Detroit, and they're going to be running a middle school program for ski snowboard.
Correct.
25 students.
Correct.
At the Tau Beta and Kosciuszko, so we're excited. We'll be on different nights, but we're excited because we'll have kids, you know, coming up through, and who knows, maybe one day we'll have a ski snowboard team. Like official athletic, I don't know.
How many kids are going to this?
20 kids.
20? So it'll be about five per.
We have four adults. Adults per 20. Yeah.
Are they mostly girls or?
Yeah, we're exactly half and half. We're 10 boys, we're 10 girls. Okay. So, and the way tensile work is, the way we always do it is boys, you know, have their own tent. There's usually 3 to 4 in a tent. And girls have their own teachers. We have our own tents too, and we put our tents pretty much in between. You know, we make these safe spaces, and we're very aware. I won't sleep the whole weekend. Just so you know.
And as always, just make sure you know if everybody's medical condition is safety.
Yeah, before we go. In fact, for the outdoor adventure team, we have a very specific health form. And we are having students do physicals too before they participate because we just want to make sure that nothing comes up that we don't know about. But yeah. So unless you have any questions.
Actually, if the board wants to ask Jessica now, please get the motion. Okay.
I think she explained well.
Yeah, you want this third. All right, thank you so much.
Okay, thank you.
So next up, we're going to go back up on the agenda for our board calendar update. So as you can see, it's the five of us. It's been five of us for a while. And I want to make sure, now that we're getting into holiday season and end of the year, I just want to confirm, one, we have to change our cows because of the holiday season, both at the end of November and December. And I just want to go through and confirm we have a quorum in advance. So for October 25th, is that still okay for y'all? Obey did inform me that he will not be mobile from now until November, and Watson has been unresponsive. So it really is just the five of us now. So October 25th, this is our cow. We're going to be meeting with Scott from MASC. We're going to start our superintendent evaluation workshop. So the first day is walking through the tool and how we're going to evaluate the super, and then we get next steps on the actual evaluation. So we do have an outside guest. I want to make sure we have quorum. Specifically, I need my choosing board members.
October 25th, I'm available.
Okay. You're good? Okay. So we're keeping October 25th. November 8th meeting is our regular agenda. There's regular business on there. I don't foresee anything lengthy, but it is right before Thanksgiving. So are you guys available?
That
was
Lansing, the delegate, and the conference as well.
Oh, you're doing
so
the whole
conference. Is there any way we can reschedule?
Okay.
We?
All right, where's the feedback coming from? All right, so we're down one. If the three of you are available, we could still technically have it on the 8th.
Yeah.
Available? Okay. Paul, head west?
I can come, but I'm going to begin to work at the dentist on the 7th, so I won't be
that much. Will you have capacity to be on the 8th? Okay. Head one? As long as it's Wednesday. Okay, so then tentatively we're fine with November 8th happening, and we know you're absent. Thank you so much for being our delegate.
Yeah.
Okay, November 22nd is literally the Wednesday before. I know. So we're not coming. So we can either do it, because we can't do it the week after, because it just would still be a good holiday. So the week before, would anyone be available on the 15th? I won't be. So I won't be here. So you're not and I'm not. That's two. Okay. So then we're going to cancel our November cow. Okay. And then December. December 13th is the second Wednesday in December. We still have school. Joanne, when does the winter break start?
It doesn't start till the 22nd.
Okay, so our cow would have to be before Friday the 22nd, so it would be December 20th. Again, I don't know what anyone's travel plans are or Christmas plans are, so would anyone be available December 20th? I would not. You would or not? Ferris is available, okay. December? Okay, so I'm down and you're down, so then we're canceling the December cow. Okay, so October 25th, we're all committing, all five of us. November 8th, four of us. November 22nd, canceled. December 13th, did we say all five were good?
Yeah, I'm good.
Good, good? Okay, and we're canceling the cap. Okay. All right, thank you all so much. That's the end of 2023. All right, moving on. We have our resolution number two, approval of consent agenda. Do I have a motion?
Yeah.
I heard Hedron seconded by. Wait, I'm sorry. Let me see something. Motion by Hedron seconded by Ferris. Resolved upon recommendation super, the Board of Ed approves the following items under consent. I'd like to remove the meeting minutes, if that's okay, and then everything else is fine. Is everyone okay with that? We have the meeting minutes, but we failed the resolution for the field trip, but I want to leave a comment on there stating we failed it because we didn't get clarity on information, not because of any concern. You know what I'm saying? I just want to comment it officially. That's the only addition I'd make to that. So we would approve the consent, moving item A to its own standalone item, it'll be resolution 3, and then B through U become A through T. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Thank you. All right, all in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries 5 ayes, 2 absent. Now, audience participation before, I have none. Reports to the board. I have Vicki at the VLA report. So, Ms. Smith, if you're ready, come on up.
Sure. Come on down.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Are there any new hires here?
On the consent agenda.
Yes.
Is that a consent agenda?
Yes.
Can you introduce yourself, please?
Hi, Leola Banks, Dickinson West, Assistant Principal.
Hi.
Actually, and then Mr. Elgahin would like us to.
Wait,
I think
we have another person.
Hi, my name is Heather Kuhneman.
I didn't get a title.
Heather Kuhneman.
For what title? What job?
Executive Director of Student Achievement.
Okay, those are going to come later, but thank you. Mr. Elgahame actually would like us to take time to recognize all the principals. We just had three wonderful presentations about student activities and affairs, and these could not be done without the building principals helping out their staff. So, Mr. Elgahame, would you like to add to that?
It's National Principal Month, so
thank
you all the principals. Yeah.
Thank you so much. You're back for National Principal Month. Thank you, Mr. Elgahame. All right, now come on up, Ms. Smith.
Sure.
I'll bring my crew. These are Hamtramck teachers, by the way.
Nice to meet you.
So I'll let them introduce themselves.
Hey, good to see you.
Before we begin, I'd like to say this. I was asked to help out with the VLI program. Little did I know at the last board meeting I would become the interim director when I wasn't here. I just want to put that out there. But I could not have done any of this without these guys here who've been very helpful. And the reason why I chose to do this, I was asked because I know for a fact that there are children who do not do well coming into the building. I also know that we have children who excel and want to continue online. So where my heart is always with children. And I'm going to do whatever I can to help them. which is why I did this, even though I was still the principal of ECE, and we were virtual, which isn't easy, and I was still the director of the GSRP program. So I really had three jobs, so I really was not trying to ignore anybody. I realized I was working, and doing it all wrong, because I was asking myself, well, who didn't know anything? And so that didn't help, but these guys have been tremendous, and I want to give them the appropriate recognition for that. So go ahead and introduce yourself.
I'm Dennis Bargowski. I've been with the system for about 15 years now, and I take care of science. Nice to see you.
I'm Jill Jenkins. I'm the elementary teacher. Sorry I was late, guys. I coach volleyball, so I rushed here, and I was hoping we'd be a little later. So I don't know what I missed. This is my second year with the program, sixth year with the district, 20 years teaching.
Hello, I'm Todd Huddleston. I teach English for the VLI program. I've been teaching for 16 years, all in Hamtramck, and it's a pleasure to be here.
My name is Lori Colley. I am social studies 6 through 12. I've been teaching in Hamtramck for 16 years, along with Todd. This is my second year with Hamtramck Public Schools, and it's an honor to be here. Yes.
So we didn't do a slideshow, I had one, but they said that didn't answer your questions, so I was kicked off the team by the team. So anyway, they're going to go ahead and start it and share the information with you.
Okay, just to add, the average amount of years that we have been here is 16 years between these four teachers here. So we are approaching the program with a lot of experience and a lot of ambition and excitement. The online schooling situation that we have here, it is necessary. I was just looking at some figures over the past week. 2016, the amount of money that has been invested in online schooling has quadrupled in 5 years. So this is not a situation that is going to be dwindling off in the next year or two. It's actually going to be growing. So as far as that is concerned, did you want to? We're going to tag team here a little bit today. So.
We got off to a bit of a rough start this year. Just there was a change in leadership, as you all know.
There wasn't anybody.
Right. And so, unfortunately, we lost a lot of our students to neighboring charter schools in Hamtramck. 118.
Are our current users
our
right
current
now.
Our current users now. We've many charter schools in the area have online programs, so the kids opted to go there. It would be very helpful if we could advertise more. I've reached out a couple times asking if we could put the VLI program on the front page of the Hamtramck Public Schools website, and or in addition to for each class or school that's listed, perhaps maybe having a dash or something saying a virtual option is available, so the kids know. I don't think the community knows that this is available, and I think that would be very helpful.
And just to add on with this, there's a lot of schools in the area that do offer online programs. We have big schools like Sterling Heights High School, Edsel Ford, Hazel Park. They're all around us, and we need to offer these opportunities for our students, primarily because of work, family, and health restrictions that do not allow them to come to school. It would be a great disservice not to be there with the VLI program for these kids because of how important it is to those kids. And there are a lot of them.
Yeah, there's a big need. For them.
Because we'd rather offer virtual learning, it's more like an independent study online, than have kids drop out of school and not finish. This gives them that opportunity to do that.
And as we know, this is a unique community, and so it gives a lot of our girls an opportunity to further their education and continue it, along with a lot of the males in our community that work. I know when I was in school in person, a lot of my boys would sleep through class because they would work all night. They would work the midnight shifts to help contribute with their families. So I think that this is a vital need in this community especially.
I think some of the art representing are...
I, go ahead.
I think some of the concerns that were brought to the board, especially, I think last month thinking directly, was parents were not being communicated with, and then students were kind of just left in limbo for a few weeks. I know that we said they had a rocky start, but how would, I guess, the VLI program communicate with parents and students if they didn't have that?
Well, for one thing, someone wouldn't be coming in late and say, here, do it. So I didn't even have any guidance there, so that was really tough. Just these guys, but they don't understand the administration part of it. And so as I was learning myself, it put us behind. So I, for example, I had an orientation, and I sent it out. I thought I was doing the right thing, spent a lot of time on it. Three kids showed up. I was so devastated. I've never had that happen. But it wasn't being communicated in where they could see it. So I didn't know that because there's no handbook. I've been working on that. There were no guidelines. So I said, well, okay, well, I'm looking through Dr. Aubin's old drive, trying to figure this out, asking them a million questions. I will tell you, Pearson, a particular young lady named Taji Willis, has helped tremendously. So once I understood how to do this, like I said, without guidelines, it's like, oh, I get it. So then we had parents come in. We gave away backpacks. We ordered backpacks because then someone said to me, why are you getting backpacks when they don't go to school anyway? So well, you got to keep your stuff there somewhere. But we did that. I felt really bad, and I don't have a problem apologizing to parents, whatever, because I know it was very stressful. So everybody who came in, I was very clear about that. I did my best. They did their best. And Pearson. But going forward, now we already have systems in place for next semester that no students can sign on now at this point because we're in October. But for next semester, students can, and we are already working on having that in place. So it won't be such a rocky start. It won't be like, oh my gosh, I have to get these kids into school, because I felt terrible about that, and they did too. We were trying our best. But, you know, when there's nothing there that tells you how to do it, and you're trying to figure it out. And I feel bad for the parents and the kids, because I know they're depending on that. My own son attends college online. We tried in person. He didn't like it at all. He prefers to attend online. He will be graduating in May. Without this online ability to do that, then I don't know if he would be graduating. So I really like that because he works on his own and is more like independent study. These guys offer tutoring. There's office hours. There's Pearson tutors. A lot of things are available for kids to succeed, particularly if they don't want to be in the building for whatever reason. So that's why this was happening. So I was inundated with like 40, 50 calls a day. I can't figure out how to do it if I'm trying to answer all those phone calls, but I still don't know the answer. But we're not there anymore. So we have someone who can testify to the fact that we are actually enrolled the child. And we can prove it.
How many students have we lost from the starting of the school year till now from the VLI program is a question that I have. This is number one. And number two, so you guys have stated that you had 0%, you know, of any kind of, you know, guidance through this process? Is that
yes,
accurate?
I was given Dr. Aubin's drive, and the other thing is, well, you can call him, but my personal feeling is if someone has left the district, it is really unprofessional for me to call them and say, hey, how do I do the job that you quit? I don't feel comfortable doing that. So so I just had to figure out myself and take online training with Pearson, bug these guys to death who really stepped up and helped and worked closely with Pearson who tried to help me too. So saying that because nobody knew, there was no history. So going forward, that is why I'm working on a handbook. So someone should be able to step in and be able to do that. Because it was a very difficult situation to be in addition to my other duties. And I, like I said, I felt terrible for the parents. I know my name was bandied about last time, but it's like, wait, I was at the doctor of physical therapy. But we don't ever want that to happen again. That's why we need a how-to handbook so it doesn't happen. Nothing should be dependent, in my opinion, on just one person in the district. When they leave, then everything falls apart. We don't want that to happen anymore.
Can you clarify for parents? Sorry, for parents. So as the board has walked through it, the VLI program is not a standalone institution. It's tied to buildings, correct?
Yes.
So does the curriculum that is offered by Pearson align with like DW, Holbrook, you know, KMS, et cetera, like all of our buildings, do they all align, or how does that work?
It's all based on Common Core state standards, which our schools in Hamtramck use as well. Would you like to add something else to that?
I'd say, yeah, we are aligned with the state of Michigan and whatever the state of Michigan
mm-hmm.
is.
No, I get that. What I'm asking is, so if I'm a Ham High student today, and I'm in person, I have a curriculum, I have classes, I have whatever. I know what I'm taking to graduate with my credits and whatnot. If I was in the VLI program, I have the option to take physics the same way I would have taken it inside the building?
It would be online.
It would be online.
It would be online, and then they can attend classes where they do. Go ahead.
Well, the only thing I did want to say is the counselors do have to approve their classes.
Yes.
So it'd be the exact same as if it was in person.
For the elementary, if you go on to Pearson, they use a lot of Envision is a book they use. Now, we don't use that in our classroom, but Envision's like one of the textbooks that we would use. So our pacing in elementary probably would not be the same. Like, I might not be in the same spot that somebody in person would be, but they will learn the same exact concepts throughout the year, just maybe at a different time. And to answer the thing about being an individual school, last year I was told if we apply to be an individual school, it will take 2 years. And I don't think that process ever started last year with Dr. Abed. So, and I don't know if we're going to do that or not, but that is an option, but it does take 2 years.
And for our students, they're still affiliated with the schools. Like, I had a senior come and talk to me, can I still go through graduation? Absolutely. Can they go to the activities at the school and be in sports and stuff? Absolutely. They're not just disappearing online. They're still part of the school. They take the assessment, like the SAT and stuff, still take that with the school. The students who have a 504 or they have a IEP, they're still part of the school, and they're still made aware of those students' particular needs.
I'd also like to point out, not only can they take physics, but they can take German. There's so many more courses available through Pearson, so they have a more, they can sort of individualize their own experience in education.
What about the dual enrollment options for the high schoolers?
There is dual enrollment. I don't know if we currently do that.
I don't think we're not offering dual enrollment through Pearson, but I'm sure we could work on that if we for an option. We also talked about honors classes, because I want kids to have every opportunity to excel no matter what program they're in, and they deserve that. But what I finally figured out is that the counselor, let's say, for example, the high school, must approve the classes, because I'm not from Michigan. I don't want to be the person who stops a kid from graduating. That's tragic. And so I don't know what's required, you know. So the counselors at the high school put together their schedule, looking at their transcripts from their past experience. Then once that was completed, then what I did was contact Pearson, who then uploaded into the students. Then I made a flyer, so we say, this is what you do when you have your classes. Keep checking, it should take a day or two. They technically weren't supposed to do that, but I wasn't in a position to, I didn't know that at the time. I said, I need help. If we want the program to work, I need you to help me do this. And they did. They did. Anytime I send something to do. The deadline is passed now, so I have a lot of students who are like, decided they don't want to go to school wherever, and they want to be virtual. But I told them, you can come next semester and you can be virtual, but to drop out now when we're in the middle of a semester, no. So
I'm just a little, I'm sorry, but I guess fixated on the previous VLI director. When he left, did he give us a 2-week notice?
He left in the middle of summer, so yes.
He did give it?
Yes.
So in that 2-week notice, I mean, did it come across anybody's like thought process to use that time for continuing on what he's built on or where he needs to work on, or how the community or the families are going to be updated, and to have a smooth transition from that one director to, you know, the person taking over from?
No.
And what was the lack of communication in that?
I don't know. I was asked August 9th or 10th. Would I be willing to help? And I know, especially through my own son's experience, like, okay, I don't want these kids not to be able to attend. So I said yes, but you know, no good deed goes unpunished. So that's kind of what I learned there. So then I was scrambling trying to figure that out. And I thought there were systems in place and it would be a lot easier to do, to be completely honest with you. And it wasn't. And I spent hours and hours and all my weekends and everything else because I really wanted to work and I wanted it to be a good program. So we won't have this problem. They've worked. They've tried to help me so much because it was like a foreign language, to be honest with you. It's very different if you're not familiar with it. It's not like something you just like pick up like that.
We weren't aware that Dr. Abbott was leaving. Yeah. I mean, I didn't know till he was gone. So, I mean, had I known, we could have definitely put something in place to facilitate this.
It's fine, you didn't know he's gone.
I had emailed him 3 times over the summer when I was working summer school and had to sit at Dickinson East in the afternoon for one class and said, is there anything you need me to do? Could I help you with anything? And he never responded. And then we found out in August. So we did try to do things ahead of time because we did have some issues with attendance last year that we wanted to get ironed out. And I kept emailing him and no response from him. So I don't know when he...
My only concern with the Iowa is our lower kids, like elementary. I know this is more so like something that somebody that's responsible. So middle school, high school, but... We were told that the teachers, they come on for a little bit, and then the kids just kind of just do their work throughout the day. Is there any way we can have, like...
So I heard you say that last time, and that's kind of why I wanted to come. That's why I was like, I got to get here. That's not true.
Okay.
I get on every day. I have office hours, and he said don't do any classes before 10 o'clock because the kids aren't going to get up early. So I have my office hours. Then I have at 10 o'clock, we do ELA for 40 minutes. Then I do small groups after that. Because we are elementary, so I still do guided reading groups. So I do a different group each day after every day doing ELA. So they're on for an hour and 10 minutes with me in the morning. Then in the afternoon, I do the same thing for math. I do my math lesson, and then I do a small group after in a different group each day. So I'm on there hour and 20 minutes in the morning, hour and 20 minutes in the afternoon, and then I have an hour of office hours. Then even last year, because a lot of our students were at the religious school, that they only could do their homework from 3 to 4, and we were done at 3, but Michelle and I were still getting on from 3 to 4 to help these kids, because that's when they were asking us questions, even though we had live tutors they could get on, but that was when they needed help from us. And so we were even going on above what we were supposed to do.
Can you backpedal? What do you mean by the students at religious school? That was separate after school program?
No, so last year, and a lot of all those kids told me they were coming back, and all of them kind of, I think, left because they didn't know what was going on right before school started. But we had 3 different schools that the students go and do their religious all day long, and we were supplying the core curriculum for them. So they would be in school. They did start logging on to live lessons at school. The teachers were letting them, but they were supposed to be from 3 to 4 doing our Pearson work. So from 3 to 4 is when they needed help and needed us. So, but they kind of left, and I'm trying to fight to get them back because I really want those kids back because we formed great relationships, and they all told me they would come back. So I don't know what happened. I think just the unknowing part.
I also think when Dr. Abbott left, they left.
Right,
because he was the one that brought him over. But
yeah.
I have a question real quick. So, do we have anything in our finances that can allocate a dedicated VLI director that would be responsible for seeing it, overseeing it, all that? Because, I mean, with all due respect, you have a lot on your plate already. You have a whole school to run, you know what I mean? And just throwing another, this is not a small project at all, and it shouldn't be put on somebody else's plate who already has their own project that they need to worry and focus on and give their 100% up for it. I'm not trying to downgrade or say, you know, you're not capable of doing it or anything, but do we have anything in any of our budgets or any grants that we can...
I think it's an open position, would have been budgeted.
We have money to pay for this position.
And is it being advertised accordingly? I mean,
it is not right now.
Because I'm going to be honest with you, for someone else to step in right now would be extremely difficult, and I think it will hurt the kids. It was a question about, like, Vicki, you're working so many hours.
If we give them enough time to transition into it with your guidance.
Right.
Not just, hey, you have 2 weeks to learn everything. Give them an adequate amount of time to learn the job.
Yes, because I do work
many nights, and I do work all weekend, I'm going to be honest with you, especially now before count day, because I don't want any kid not to be in there.
Right.
Especially when they want to be.
We want to, you know, make sure that the kids at the end of the day have the best opportunities, period. And we're not providing it by getting somebody who can run a program independently and have that whole team that can make this a successful program, then it's just destined to fail from the beginning.
But it hasn't.
But it hasn't, but I'm saying it can be destined to fail if it's not.
We won't let it.
No, okay. We won't.
Yeah, I think the biggest challenge here would just be finding a qualified candidate that could step into the position. So.
And what I did want to say, she does. She sends emails at 9 o'clock, 10 o'clock, 11 o'clock at night.
And I'm not doubting what you're doing that.
And she's working, and she has from day one. I do have to say, I know she has my support, and I know, I don't want to speak for everybody else, but I know where they're at.
Right, and like also, I said, I'm not downgrading or downplaying the amount of work you can do, but, you know, just realistically, humanly possible, there's a breaking point for everybody, and we don't want you to reach a breaking point faster than, you know, it needs to happen. I'm sorry.
And what I will say real quickly, one last thing is, it's not myself, but others that are working this and who have worked it, because we have a lot of experience, do have administration certifications in case for some reason the transition were to be needed.
Mm-hmm. And why isn't this, why are we advertising the position and
I don't know why we haven't.
Joanne, can you note it for Ms. Ahmed to put in the board report her updates on the strategy, please? Thank you, Mr. Hedwan. Anyone else? Any other questions?
I think, honestly, they came to me because I, after doing that summer school rather quickly, and then my experience with technology, which I really love technology, so I think that's one of the reasons why she asked me. And because my son calls me the make it happen captain, and that's what I was determined to do no matter what.
We're thankful and grateful for you to, you know, step up to the challenge, you know, but like I said, it's nothing, you know, demeaning or saying you can't do the job, but I'm trying to, for the sanity of you, you know, just your sanity and everybody else's sanity, and making sure this program survives and can be the best of its, you know, ability. Is I feel like we need somebody who's
full-time,
head-on, you know, can guide the whole team and work together as a group to make this, you know, one of the best VLI programs we can.
Thank you. I just want to say one more comment that, you know, being a virtual, in the Virtual Learning Institute, our day-to-day does not look like an in-person traditional day. Yeah. Like, I worked last night till 9 o'clock. Mm-hmm. Like, there is always something to do. There's more than, well, not that they're in person, there is too, but it's not as regimented, let's say, like you have first hour, second hour, third hour. Our day looks a lot different than a traditional in-person teacher.
What time does the school day end?
It's supposed to end at 3, but...
But we don't.
Yeah, we don't.
No, I know, no. She mentioned that the kids came 3, 4 to do some school work.
Well, they work at 1 a.m., 3 a.m., 4 a.m.
They could work at any time.
Yeah.
The one point that's nice about this is all the teachers record their lessons, and if they choose to come in and view a lesson at a specific time, they can do that anytime they want, which is comforting for a student who has to work a very unstructured work environment or family environment. It makes life better for them and easier to succeed, which helps out the position. So,
some of the kids really exceed with the state of learning. They really, really do. But I do want to say this for myself in the last, if anybody ever has a question, feel free to reach out to me. Mm-hmm. Or any of us, I will lay out. So, okay.
I got one more. You do science.
I do.
Is that K through 12?
I do mine middle school and high school.
Okay, because she mentioned that she does the ELA.
Yes.
Do the kids do science and social studies?
Yes.
Yes. About elementary?
Yes. Yeah, we do 4 through 12.
Okay. Are they getting, like, do you, like, the lesson and center? I mean, like, well, lesson, and then they could do the lesson with you, and then they'll work on it by themselves.
So science and social studies, we don't do a live lesson for.
Okay.
It's more like if they need help after school on a project or a test, that's more of the self-paced
part, just because we couldn't fit it in our schedule. When I have three grades or four grades, I couldn't teach four grades, four subjects, and get it all in a day. So Dr. Bed last year said, just help them with science and social studies, do live lessons for math and ELA, because I mean, we even see that in the classroom, that that's our main push is our ELA and math, and science and social studies always gets thrown to the side, which stinks because I am a social studies major and I love social studies and part of a social studies project. But so I don't do live lessons for the science and social studies, but I do help them when they have. They don't have a lot of questions. It's kind of easy. There is a couple like portfolio projects they struggle with that I need to help them with.
What's the youngest grade that someone has registered?
Fourth grade this year. We decided after last year, kindergarten, first grade, and second grade could not.
No,
third
much.
Grade might have been iffy, but we decided to do fourth through six.
And then I think the last question for me is, so you're starting a handbook, Ms. Smith?
Yes.
Do you know when you'll have it ready to review or read?
I would say by the next board meeting. Because I've put some things in there and I don't like the way it's explains things. I need to streamline it. And I want them to look at it too beforehand. Yes, because I want someone to be able to walk in here and say, oh yes, I can do this. Can't write everything, but there are videos to see and things that help parents.
I think they should have the standard student code of conduct book and then include whatever additional BLI.
Absolutely.
Sure.
But
because
I also,
they still, you know, have to adhere to the standard.
Yes. And because we also talk about that and discipline and stuff, and then we expect the kids to behave just like they're in the building, you know, to follow what we expect here in Hamtramck. But this might take a little longer, like what to do if you come in and you're the director, like how to book, because I'm going to tell you that was extremely difficult, because especially when I was doing it wrong and sending stuff out with three kids showed up for orientation, that was very defeating.
No, it's okay.
It was good though.
Does anyone have any questions about the ELA program?
I think it's a wonderful program, and
you
guys have been doing a very awesome job with communication and all that, so thank you for that. One thing I'd like to add is I think students should be involved in like picture day today was.
Yes.
I think virtual students should be, you know, invited to that.
They were supposed to be.
Yeah, along with maybe like award ceremonies and stuff like that. I think they should be involved as well.
I agree, and they're supposed to be.
Yeah.
And I've sent out several messages that say that because they're still part of the school. This is just a different curriculum, but they're still part of the school. So they need to be involved, and so that's part of the socialization process that we do in education. So they absolutely should. So that's another area that we can work on too. I do send out tons of stuff now. I know how to, and I was given access. That was another issue, was getting access and permissions to do that with technology. My hands were tied. That really hurt. So
thank you all so much.
Yeah.
Anyone have any additional questions, just give us an email if you want to be on the agenda. So, thank you so much.
Yes,
we
have other things planned. Yeah.
Thank you.
All right. All right, next up, resolution number 3. Remember it, now it's approval of meeting minutes. Do I have a motion? All right, Hedwan, do I have a second?
Second.
Second to Falgahane. Result of the Board of Education does hereby approve the September regular meeting minutes with correction. I would like to make a correction to, Joanne, let me know when you have ready for the notes.
Go ahead.
Okay. Resolution number, where is it? Approval of field trip. Resolution number 11, motion failed. Can you please add the comment that Board of Education did not have clarity on chaperone numbers? And we did follow up with Mr. Albridge, and he gave us clarity and he made it a day trip. Or that's too long. Let me read that. Board of Education could not confirm amount of chaperones. Mr. Albridge followed up and changed it to day trip. Is the board okay with that comment? Or does anyone that voted against it like to leave a comment? All right, with that said, resolution number 3, approval of meeting minutes. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries, 5 ayes, 2 absent. Now resolution number 4, approval of overnight field trip. Do I have a motion? I heard Hedwan, Hall. Result of the Board of Ed does hereby approve the request of Jessica Madden, Kimberly Hatcher-Lord, and Ajoka Wilson to take approximately 20 students on a trip to the Thunder Bay Maritime Heritage Museum in Alpena, Michigan, October 13th to the 15th. Do we have any additional discussion? All right. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries, 5 ayes, 2 absent. Resolution number 5, approval of employment. Do I have a motion? I have Hedwan. Do I have a second?
Second.
Elka Haim, resolved that the Board of Ed does hereby approve the employment of Kimberly Collins as the Special Ed Compliance Manager of Hamtramck Schools, annual salary $90,000, prorated per state, per start date, effective September 25th, 2023. Do you have discussion?
Yep. Was it internal, external, how many interviews?
Oh, I will read that little hiring thing to you. It's in our drive.
Okay.
So there were only two candidates who applied for this position, one of which worked with Miss, oh, I'm not gonna say the name. I don't know if I'm allowed to, in a previous school. Although blank met the qualifications, blank was ruled out for the interview process, and then we interviewed Kimberly Collins. And I'm not, some of this feels personal, so I'm not gonna read it, but the board has access to it. If you want to take time to read it, please feel free. I don't wanna put anyone's personal information out there if they're not an elected official.
It's on a single board that
Someone that this position.
Just for this position, all five positions. So we can take time. Oh, okay. How do you vote, Elka Haim?
Aye.
Paul?
Aye.
Hedwan?
Aye.
Ferris?
Aye.
And I resolution passes 5 ayes, 2 absent. Resolution number 6. Motion by Ferris Ives, seconded by Hedwan. Result of the Board of Ed does hereby approve. Oh, sorry.
6.
Kimberly, are you here? I keep forgetting to do this.
I don't think Kimberly's here.
Okay, good. I caught myself early though. Resolution number 6, motion by Ferris, seconded by Hedwan. Result of the Board of Ed does hereby approve the employment of Heather Cookman as the Executive Director of Student Achievement, annual salary of $110 prorated per start date, effective upon approval and provided proper notice. We have discussion. All right, how do you vote, Ferris?
Aye.
Hedwan?
Aye.
Gahang?
Aye.
Hall?
Aye.
Aye. Resolution passes 5 ayes, 2 absent. Is Heather here? Heather, stand up. Come on up. Now, congratulations and welcome to the team. All right, resolution number 7, approval employment. Do I have a motion? I heard Hedwan. Do I have a second? Ferris. Result that the Board of Ed does hereby approve the employment of Leola Banks as the AP of DW Elementary, Dickinson West Elementary, Step 5 of the HOD contract, prorated for start date effective October 2nd, 2023. Do I have a discussion? All right, how do you vote, Elka Haim?
Aye.
Paul? Hedwan? Ferris? Aye. Resolution passes 5 ayes, 2 absent. Is Leola Banks here?
Okay, hi, congratulations.
Resolution number 8, approval employment. Do I have a motion? I have Hedwan. Do I have a second?
Second.
I heard Ferris first. Result that the Board of Ed does hereby approve the employment of Ayanna Dance as the AP of Hamtramck High. Step 4 of the HOD contract prorated per start date effective upon approval and provided proper notice. Do I have discussion? All right, how do you vote, Ferris?
Aye.
Hedwan?
Aye.
Elka Haim?
Aye.
Hall?
Aye.
Thank you. And I resolution passes 5 ayes, 2 absent. Resolution number 9, approval of employment. Do I have a motion? I have a Hedwan. Do I have a second? Elka Haim. Result of the Board of Ed does hereby approve the employment of Tiffany Cobb as the Director of Student Services, Step 8 of the HOD contract, prorated per start date effective November 6, 2023. Do we have a discussion?
Yeah, because that's not.
No, that's a different one. Jack uploaded it right here. Let me see. Oh, I'm in the wrong place. It is in the drive for now, it's called. Okay. So there is a, it's a PDF of the position and the rationale for it. It's the IEP manager, right, Jack?
No, this is the special ed director. I didn't upload anything about the special ed director. We had unexpectedly had Mrs. Parkman resign back in September, and we reposted for the position, and we had, at that point in time, we had probably 7 or 8 people apply because it was after school had started. Usually the summertime is when people want to get new jobs. but we still got 8 people to apply. We interviewed 3 or 4 people, and we picked Ms. Cobb as our director based on her qualifications. She's been a special ed director at a charter for the past 8 years, and then before that was a speech and language pathologist by trade.
So what's the difference between the manager and the director?
The director is going to be the overall leader of the department. The manager is going to help the director make sure that there are fewer and fewer compliance issues, things that we need to make sure get corrected and don't happen during the during the regular school year. We had too many problems last year that we had to try to solve. And we're trying to get on top of those problems early on this year rather than waiting until something happens. So having an extra person in the department will make a huge difference to trying to make sure we are in compliance and we don't run afoul of the state or the county mm-hmm. with what we do.
And this for all our schools, correct?
Yes, for all schools.
Do you want to take a look? Awesome. As long as we don't get no complaints, we get complaints.
Well, It's a situation where there will be complaints because people are always not going to be pleased with everything that happens every time. But we're going to have fewer and fewer complaints by having these people on board and people with experience on board, because both the compliance manager and the new director have lots of experience that they can bring to the table.
Additional question? Mm-hmm. All right. How do you vote, Ferris?
Aye.
Alkahane?
Aye.
Hezlon?
Aye.
Paul? Aye. Ayash, aye. Resolution passes 5 ayes, 2 absent. Resolution number 10. Maisel representative, I heard Hezlon for a motion. Do I have a second?
Second.
Alkahane? Resolve the Board of Ed does hereby designate James Larson Schindler be named director and Courtney Jackson be named alternate director to the Maisel Joint Risk Management Trust. So I did call Sherry Linen. I asked her what this was and has she done it before. She was our rep prior to her leaving. And now you're their new CFO, so it's going to you. And then Courtney Jackson is your accountant, correct?
Yep.
Do we have any other clarifiers or questions? Does everyone understand what the rest will do, or do you want to explain that to us?
What I will do?
Yeah.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah, it's a cooperative of 26 districts mm-hmm. that, what we do is we basically unite and we go out and share with 26 districts to get better pricing on insurance. So myself and Courtney will be the representatives for the district. We go and we vote at the meetings. So we basically represent the district at the meetings.
Okay. Any questions or discussion? How do you vote, Hedlund?
Aye.
Ferris?
Aye.
Elgahang?
Aye.
Hall?
Aye.
And ISI resolution passes 5 ayes, 2 absent. Resolution number 11, awarding a bid. Do I have a motion? I have Hedlund. Do I have a second?
Second.
I have Ferris first. Resolved the Board of Education hereby awards a bid for the HPS Phase 4 HVAC at KIPP, Kosciuszko, and DW as follows, 61 as follows, with total project costs not to exceed $4,666,557,000. It's funded through ESSERS. We have 3 companies right on time. Here on there, and then additional allowances and project costs of $736,000. Oh, that's a good one. Anyways, we have our architect rep here as well as Rich for questions.
Here you go.
Thank you.
Are there any questions for them?
This is for the HVAC.
Yeah.
And then we got all 3, so we're working with all 3 of these people.
Yeah, it looks, take it away, why do we bid for these things?
This bid's a little bit different than the last ones we've done. This time we're doing it like through a construction management, so we break it down into the individual trades that we need.
Mm-hmm.
And, yeah, basically it's just, it gives us the opportunity to receive more bids, and it gives us a better selection, a better options in who we choose.
Are we making sure that the dates
are not going to affect the start of the school year.
Or the middle or the end.
So there's...
We need to make sure that's part of these contracts.
There's a lot involved in this one here to get everything done. And basically, I mean, we're doing everything we possibly can right now to get this to go.
I mean, sure, but that was also said to us prior bids, and it delayed our start school year by a lot. So I think I'm just going to ask more explicitly, what is the timeline? When do you anticipate it being finished, and how does it affect our students' learning?
Well, we want to start it as soon as the kids are out.
So June.
This is the reason, basically, why we're going with this different bid process this time. Like I say, it'll give us more control over everything. And I mean, I'm pretty confident on this one, going this route. I think this is our best bet, especially with the size of the job this time around.
And we have Mike Gagneau here from Frank Rewald & Sons. They're the construction manager. They're going to manage these three contractors. So they're assembling the schedule. They're making sure they show up, excuse me, on time. And some of the challenges we've had with these previous projects has been equipment deliveries. You know, we get promises, not we, but the contractors get promises from the manufacturers. They change. They can't deliver. We're still waiting on some things, I believe. But Mike, maybe you want to add a couple comments there.
So in this bid process, we took a little different tact. We if you've been seeing the contract recommendations, there's actually an additional cost on the electrical, and that's to guarantee delivery of the equipment in time so that we don't have the problem of the school not being able to open in September. So we will be we'll be working all winter long here, prepping, making sure that everything's ready to go, and then come June when school's out, we'll be in the building. There's some things that may actually happen previous to school being out, like after hours and those kinds of things, you know, getting things ready so that we're ready to hit the ground running in June. And the game plan discussed with all the subcontractors already is to be done before school starts.
What will be the point of contact for communicating with this district, the board, and the superintendent throughout this entire project?
I will be.
Okay. Because, I mean, I just would like to, you know, better communication overall, you know, just keeping us more informed so we're not, as board members, also finding out a week before school starts that, hey, you're not going to be in school because we're not ready, you know?
We've set up a meeting with the administration to be happening once a week just to make sure that the communication is flowing. Hopefully it'll be a little different this time around. I mean, we're just getting into it, just starting now, right? So those projects...
Sure, but for this project, after phase four of HVAC is complete at KMS and DW, what's going to happen? Like, what actually is going to get fixed or repaired or whatever?
The overall scope of the project is mechanical units in each individual classroom. Mm-hmm. So it's a very similar setup to the other schools, where each classroom will have its own unit that will heat and cool. There will be larger units that are either ground-mounted or mounted on the roof that will handle larger spaces. Cafeteria, gymnasium, and all of those will work together to provide heating and cooling throughout the entire facility.
And along with that, there's some electrical upgrades to power that new equipment, right? So the electrical has to be upgraded to power the new equipment.
And you're anticipating this week, this will get done before the first week of school, which is August 2024?
I don't know what the first day of school is. Is it? But it's through this, I think the 16th of August is what we've said is the date to be completed. I think I don't have that in front of me, but I think it's like the Friday of the 16th of August. Whatever the Friday is of that week.
So, you know, just enough time to prepare so the teachers have enough time to go in and prepare their classrooms to, you know, with adequate amount of time. Because we're sending them at 7 a.m. once the next week of school.
We also have some other resources that the district did not have for helping to move people back in and out, right? So they have to pack up all their things, move that out, but we have some more resources that can move them back in within a day's time versus a week's time. Type of thing. So
Okay, and by next month, so if we approve this tonight, by next month, Rich, can you get us an update on what has moved or what has ordered, what was whatever, et cetera? Because these are ESSER dollars. So we have a deadline, but when these dollars can be spent?
Just, you know, maybe get a head start with DTE. I mean, I feel like that was one of the biggest headaches was trying to, you know, have a timeline with them, find out. So.
We're already working on getting a work order right now for the next summer's project. We've made a call to DTE already.
Okay.
That is a big problem.
No, there was a lot of big problems, and we're going to move forward with projects, hopefully if this passes tonight. But we want more clarity along the way. I don't want to find out after the fact something happened. Not even through Rich or our architect firm, our construction manager, we found it out through staff and parents. Like, that's not appropriate for the board not to get this information from y'all firsthand. So again, as things are being updated, Rich, please send it to Ms. Ahmed. She can put it in our board report. All right? Any other discussion?
Can we just make sure these contractors are doing their job? I know we got the manager to go around and look at it. Just make sure they, you know, doing their job and not just throwing stuff up there. You know?
Thank you, Ms. Hall. Any other discussion or comments for our team? All right, with that said, how do you vote, Edwin?
Aye.
Ferris?
Aye.
Elgaham?
Aye.
Hall?
Aye.
And Ayash? Aye. Resolution passes 5 ayes, 2 absent. Again, updates in real time. Thank you so much. All right, audience participation. I'm only going to go through the ones that were submitted before the meeting started. So this portion of the agenda is for citizens to address any concerns or comments to the board. The board will listen, take comments and questions under advisement and not respond at this time. The presiding officer will refer questions to the super, who's not here. For research and response, persons wishing to address the Board of Ed must complete an audience participation form and submit it to the president before the meeting starts. Forms must be filled out completely to be accepted. First person on my list is Vicki Smith. Come on up.
The last time I spoke was last October, so I'm keeping with tradition once a year. I would just like to say that I have given my all to this district. I absolutely have. And I've always been a person who feels like if I am working at a school, I expect that I would be able to bring my children there. And if I can't do that, then I'm not doing my job. So as a principal, it is a very difficult job. It's not fun. I've tried to go back to the classroom before, and nobody let me go. So I'm just saying that when we're at a board meeting or anything like that, please be aware of that. I know it's Principals Month, and I'd like to thank you for that, for acknowledging that, because it's not typically done. And it's lonely at the top, and it's difficult. You know, we went back and we were virtual. That was certainly not my choice. It was very difficult because all summer I was in different places. I didn't have my own place, which also affected the LI. I'm just saying that my name should not be bandied about at a board meeting like it was last week when I wasn't even here because of physical therapy, because it was my understanding we don't do that. And the reason why I'm saying that is I don't want to be targeted. If I'm wrong, I'm here. Anybody can come talk to me rather than having being publicly exposed or targeted in a board meeting. That's hurtful. The bigger you are, the bigger feelings you have. I'm just saying. So I want to make that clear that we're respectful of each other. And that we think about how are we going to get along and move forward, because I am very committed to this district. I drive from Ann Arbor, and my own family asked me to get another job because last year was extremely difficult and painful. But I'm telling you, I love these kids, and I'm going to do whatever I can for them that's within the scope of everything that I have. So I'm asking people to be aware of that. Principals every day show up, and then, you know, we're caught in the middle a lot of times, and we're doing the absolute best we can. And I just want everyone to know that, and I appreciate that. I could be like Snoop Dogg and say, I want to thank me for believing in me. I want to thank me for doing all this hard work. I want to thank me for having no days off, which is the truth. And I want to thank me for never quitting, because I am here and I'm never quitting on any of these kids. But then it's also October's Anti-Bullying Month. And I think we talked today to how me, when I said I would like everybody to focus on that at all the schools. Because we need to think about that. What can we do to make the world a better and more peaceful place? Coming to the board meeting,
30 seconds.
Okay, and having a positive attitude and start focusing on all the great things like those kids singing here today, Lean On Me. We should all be able to do that, to say you can lean on me. I'm here to help you. I'll do whatever I can. But I would like us to go forward and focus on positive
positivity and unity as a district. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Next up, I have Therese Comer. Therese Comer.
Okay, excuse me. Let me just get myself together. Okay, go ahead. Last time I was here, I feel like I want to say thank you to Jihan for kind of understanding where I was coming from when someone said something that I found to be harmful and detrimental, and then I was kind of blown off about it. Then mockingly told everything is racist, like I'm an idiot. So I did some research because maybe some of you are not familiar with the history of black words in American in the American language. This is an article. It was written for the St. Louis American in 2006. And I'm just going to kind of go through a little bit of it so that even if you don't care, you are aware of where people in your community are coming from. Because it doesn't seem like some of you know that or are aware of this. So mainstream white America has long had a history of giving blackness evil, unhealthy, hostile, and morbid representations. Any child with basic reading skills can easily find in any American dictionary calculated and multiple uses of the term black in ways that are peculiar and unfriendly. Consider black market, black list, black eye, black out, black box, black mood, black magic, black death, black sheep, black face, black hand, black head, black hole, black shirt, black male, black leg, black ball, black mark, and the list goes on. These negative ways of symbolizing blackness are in daily use in human circles of all kinds, including by black-skinned persons. These symbols are used literally without one seemingly thinking about skin color. You should think about it, though. If you are African, ancestry, heritage, and identity. This should be of concern to any black person, particularly when the symbol of white has been historically free of negative connotations and representations. People of African descent should learn to avoid using these long-standard, dispiriting, and degrading symbols. Black scholars of the English language should start a campaign for the removal of these negative usages from standard dictionaries. So again, I know I got 30 seconds, I got you, but I want to thank you for at least trying to recognize the situation. I want to thank you for at least recognizing that there was something that was problematic. And despite, like I said, kind of being blown off and, I mean, I was enraged, I will say that, but again, I understand that everybody doesn't understand where African-American history comes from, which it is American history as well. So hopefully we can all keep that in mind for the future. Thank you.
Thank you. And last, I have Josh Hanskett. Josh Hanskett.
Hanskett.
Say it again.
Hanskett. Sorry. Josh, I'll be out there.
Okay. Hello, thank you for having me here today. I am here to talk to you about some concerns that myself and my coworkers at Tau Beta have about an upcoming dangerous situation for our students. If you are unaware, which I would be surprised that you would be unaware, Tau Beta has broken AC heating units. They are dual units, and they are currently not functioning. And this was true in the summer, and we were suffering through some hot days, and now we're suffering through some cold days. It is not safe for kids to learn in a class that is not heated. And the concern that we have as well is that we don't have a timeline for when that's going to be fixed, but I do have a timeline for you when it's going to get colder, and it's next week, and the week after that. We don't have much time until it is winter in Tau Beta, and it is going to be cold. And we do not know when we are going to have replacement units. There have been emails sent with lack of responses, and we're worried because not only do we have to put in those units in order to be able to learn in the building, That is a construction project in of itself. At the high school, they had to bring out a big old crane to lift those giant things, blocking off the whole street. It has dangers of things falling and stuff like that. What is going to happen for the kids when that's being installed? Are we going to give them hard hats? Are we going to go virtual? These are the questions my coworkers and I have been asking for since the beginning of the school year. And we thought we had some answers, and now we're hearing nothing. And which is why I'm coming to you guys today. And I'm hoping that you guys could use your influence to follow up with the people that need to be followed up with, so that way our kids can be warm this winter. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Next up, we have our board discussion. Go ahead. I can explain that. Yep. So typically, the public comment form should be submitted before. The president can choose to accept them after. I'm not doing that today.
Okay. So one thing. What time does the school board meeting start?
6 p.m.
6 p.m. Okay. Did you see how packed it was in here at 6 p.m.?
Sure. Yes. And we accepted them also after.
Any parking spots outside?
No.
Yeah. No. Okay. So how do you expect things to happen?
Again, I'm not accepting
anything.
Okay.
My next thing is.
No. Thank you.
No. Is this because of my OCR complaint?
No.
Can
you make a comment to get follow-up with the super and Rich about the Tavia projects for the Board of Education? Thank you.
The superintendent didn't meet with me. She refused to meet with me. I have two things. She will not meet with me.
Parent-student handbook. Last year I asked that it was to be signed and printed to...
Is that all?
All the families,
really?
So they can have it sent and submitted prior to the beginning of the year. Has that been done, Joanne, that we know of?
I'm sorry, I was saying
okay,
that.
So last year I made a big emphasis on making sure that every student has the parent student handbook given to them first day of school so they can have signed and returned.
You can decide because you don't want to take mine because it came in late.
Can we check
because
with
your buddy, Ms. Ahmed, wasn't okay. here? Okay.
Thank you.
Yeah, you guys can do whatever you guys want to do.
Order.
All right, back to what I was saying, Ms. Joanne, can you please follow up with Ms. Ahmed and have her respond to the board and CC all the principals regarding the parent-student handbook and if it's been delivered to the students and if they've gotten them signed, because that's something that was very high on the agenda about making sure to get done prior to the school year starting. I mean, at the school year starting. We are on week, what, four, going on?
Six
now? And I'm still hearing that students still haven't received these handbooks. I'm still hearing that teachers, the faculty handbook has not been given out, and so I would like an update from that, like, as soon as possible.
Okay.
From the sound.
Yeah. And then you go to the Talbea.
And actually, I would like to make sure that they are, you know, given to the students, and this matter is addressed promptly by all the principals.
And Joanne, you know, to the Tau Beta Capitals project for the interim. Okay. Anything else from the board?
I have a question about the handbook. So they can't look online in the handbook and then send the form home to be signed, or you want an actual, because we just got back to the building, so we're behind on everything.
Yeah, we printed actual ones,
if I'm not mistaken. So can Ms. Ahmed deal with the logistics of that? Mr.
Okay.
Ahmed, we can answer that.
All right.
Thank you.
Sure.
All right. Anything else from the board? Resolution 12, adjournment. Do I have a motion? I have had one. Second. Okay. Get Hame. Result of the regular meeting be adjourned at 7:35 p.m. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries 5-0. Thank you.